All right, thanks so much, Monica. Well, this Friday is the 5th anniversary of Michael Brown's death that turned into months of protest, riots, reflection, and change. It continues to this day, and Rabbi Susan Talve of Central Reform Congregation was on the front lines. She joins us with a look back, a look at the present, and perhaps a look into the future. And thanks so much for coming in, Rabbi. It's good to see you again.
It's good to see you, too.
The image of you with leaders of other faiths, I don't remember what day it was, but it was during a march, and you were kneeling down. Tell us about that moment.
Every night, the clergy came out to support the young protesters. We were trying to find our place in the protest because we knew that something important was happening. Mike Brown Jr. was killed, and we knew that this was a tipping point for America. And so one night, the escalator, and we were looking for our, we knew it wasn't going to be in the church or the synagogue. That was not going to be our place in this movement.
So you took the synagogue to the street
took it to the street, every night at about 11 o'clock, the violence from the police would escalate. The militarization of the police was getting really more and more difficult for
and
the
riots young people. Increased as well.
They did. Well, and I think they were connected.
Yeah.
Yeah, the riots were spurred on by the militarization of the police. You could kind of make that case. Anyway, that night, when the sound order would go into effect, the police would try to push the protesters away. And they, of course, you know, were claiming the streets, our streets. And so that night, it looked like the police were about to arrest the young people and a group of clergy. We just knelt down in the street and we began to pray.
And what were your prayers?
Our prayers were for the violence to end. Our prayers were to make streets that were safe for the young people who were rising up and saying, as black and brown people, the streets are not safe for us, are not safe for our children. I heard two amazing young women, queer women, who were protest leaders, say to the police officers, look at me. Don't let me be invisible. I'm a teacher. I'm a student. I'm a nurse. I'm a mother. And that captured my heart. These were my children too. So we knelt down in the street and the police backed off. They did. I think they heard our prayers and the young people came and they put their hands on our backs.
Your message remains the same to this day. And as you look into the future, what has been the one big accomplishment and what still needs to be done? Let's even leave that because that would go on.
Sure.
Well, but what's the biggest accomplishment?
Okay. Well, let me say that 5 years later, our streets are no safer than they were 5 years ago.
Well, we have kids getting shot every day.
We do. And so if Mike Brown Jr. was on the street today, he would be at just as much risk, you know. So we have to face that. But for me, as a white person, I do feel a shift in the white community. I think people's eyes are becoming open and, you know, everybody has to be part of the solution.
There's more empathy.
Well, there's more recognition that this is all of our problems and these are our children. And the black, white, brown divides are not real. You know, the racism and the divisions and the disparities and the systemic racism affects us all.
Yeah. As I always say, we're all Americans.
We are.
Yeah, and we're in one country. Yeah. Rabbi, thanks so much for coming
in.
Sure. We need to expand this conversation
where we
have more time.
We do. There's so much to say. Can I tell you one great thing
One great thing. Yeah.
So at Washington University, Jason Purnell did this amazing study in healthcare disparities for the black and brown community called For the Sake of All. In Ferguson, there is, and it, one of the things it showed was that low birth weight babies and infant mortality in the black community is not because of poor education, not because of
stress.
It's because of the stress of racism.
And I know that they've opened a birthing center for women in Ferguson.
And
so
those are the kinds of cultural shifts and awarenesses, I think, that will begin to bring about change.
Rabbi, I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Randy?